Right, okay, so that's now recording, and then I'll have to remember to change it and everything, but hey, then at least anyone who's not here can join with us. I think it's all straightforward. I think everybody's been before, so they know what's happening. As before, we're trying to be as vigilant as we can be on the basis that if we are, then even if somebody who had COVID came to our services, nobody else would get it. And that way, we can be pretty confident and safe coming, and you can feel safe coming, and we can encourage others to come. So if you can, try and keep your distance, which is so difficult to do all the time, isn't it? And also wash your hands and the door handles, and I mean, we've done all that, but wash your hands and things regularly. Really, if we do those things, that's most of what we need to do. And also, we are able to continue on with the knit and natter and other things as an organisation, even though the limit is six in personal situations. If we've got a risk assessment and we act in a COVIDly safe way, we are able to do other things. So if people feel there is a need to have a meeting, the reason we've set up the space with the pews out is primarily so that we can meet in a group socially distanced, so that's helpful. So if there are things that you think it would be really good to make happen because people need it, then do ask and we'll try and organise it. I think that's all we need for the moment, apart from I need to have the right service book.
Works if we sing.
so we won't have a Gloria today. We'll move on to the Bible readings at this point. So if we could have the reading from Philippians, please.
The reading is from Philippians chapter 1, beginning to read at verse 21. For to me, living is Christ, and dying is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labour for me, and I do not know which I prefer. I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary for you. Since I am convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with all of you for your progress and joy in faith, so that I may share abundantly in your boasting in Christ Jesus when I come to you again. Only live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent and hear about you, I will know that you are standing firm in one spirit, striving side by side with one mind for the faith of the gospel, and are in no way intimidated by your opponents. For them, this is evidence of their destruction, but of your salvation. And this is God's doing, for he has graciously granted you the privilege not only of believing in Christ, but of suffering for him as well. Since you are having the same struggles that you saw I had, and now hear that I still have, this is the word of the Lord.
We stand for a reading from Matthew, the Good News of Jesus Christ. The Gospel was written in the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 20, beginning to read from verse 1. Jesus says, "For the kingdom of heaven is like the landowner who went out early one morning to hire workers for his vineyard. He agreed to pay the normal daily wage and sent them out to work. At 9 o'clock in the morning, he was passing through the marketplace and saw people standing around doing nothing. So he hired them, telling them he would pay them whatever was right at the end of the day. So they went to work in the vineyard. At noon and again at 3 o'clock, he did the same thing. At 5 o'clock in the afternoon, he was in town again and saw some people standing around. He asked them, 'Why haven't you been working today?' They replied, 'Because no one hired us.' The landowner told them, 'Then go out and join the others in my vineyard.' That evening he told the foreman to call the workers in and pay them, beginning with the last workers first. When those hired at 5 o'clock were paid, each received a full day's wage. When those who hired first came to get their pay, they assumed they would receive more. But they too were paid a day's wage. When they received their pay, they processed it to the owner. 'Those people worked only 1 hour, and yet you've paid them just as much as you paid us, who worked all day in the scorching heat.' He answered one of them, 'Friend, I haven't been unfair. Didn't you agree to work all the day for the usual wage? Take your money and go. I wanted to pay this last worker the same as you. Is it against the law for me to do what I want with my own money? Should you be jealous because I am kind to others? So those who are last now will be first then, and those who are first will be last.'" This is the good news of Jesus Christ.
Praise to you, Lord.
As we stand, let us pray. Dear Lord, we ask that you will help us to understand and live out Scripture, and that it may be a blessing to us and those who we know. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
Please do sit down. Right. Last week we were hearing about the extraordinary expectation that God had as those who are Christians, on those who are Christians. And this week, Jesus carries on with extraordinary expectation. He wants us to be superheroes. I'm sure you're all great Marvel comic fans? No, maybe not. Or, no, you see, I tried to find a superhero costume in our house and I couldn't find one. I just didn't have one. We did once have a Spider-Man costume, but I think it was when one of the children was about three. I couldn't even find that. But, you know, all these heroes that we have in our stories, in television stories, in films, I'm sure some of you like Tolkien and some of you like J.K. Rowling and things, they're people who have special powers, aren't they? And those people who have those special powers achieve amazing things. They are extraordinary. And one of the things that Dumbledore says to Harry Potter at one point is, it's not the power you have, it's the decisions you make which matter. And often that is true, and that is what makes us extraordinary. It's not the powers we have, but the decisions we make that make us extraordinary, that give us power. It's where we turn at the right moment to the power of God that we are able to do extraordinary things. Now, in this reading from the Gospel, Jesus is talking about God being generous, being extraordinarily generous to those who are least well off. To those who were reasonably well off, he was just normally generous. But to those who were least well off, he was extraordinarily generous. And he gave to them more than they deserved. And that's what we use the word grace for, don't we? Grace means receiving from God more than we deserve. And when we talk of grace, that's what we are experiencing of God, that we do not deserve what he gives to us, but he still gives it. We may only work for an hour. The Old Testament reading talks of Jonah, what a wonderful character, he does everything wrong, but God uses him. Talks of Nineveh, a place that was a complete mess, but God still loved them. St. Paul wants to go and to be in heaven, in the Philippians reading, because he knows that will be a better place. But he realizes he should stay on earth because there is a task to complete. There is things to get on with. There are places to find God's power and use it for extraordinary ways, to make ordinary things better, change them for good. And so, if we receive extraordinary generosity from God, we should be extraordinarily generous to others. When there is occasion that we want to think it's not fair, or that somebody deserves less than us, or so on, we actually need to challenge ourselves and allow God's power to meet us and to help us. We need to use the decision we have over the moment we're in, with God's help, to make sure that that moment is lived in the best way. And if we do so, then we act in a way that helps others, that transforms them, that hopefully they go, I wasn't expecting that. Why have they done that? What was it that has made them be like that? And hopefully they see that it is God who helps us over time. They may do. They may see that God is there. And of course there are others sometimes who do this extraordinary kindness without the power of God. And we must acknowledge them. It's not that Christians are specially powerful. It's that God helps us to be powerful. And we aren't always perfect at it. One of the things that we are so able and unable to do is to come back and say sorry when things have gone wrong. And that's one of the things that strengthens and enables us to be those who go forward step by step into better and better ways. So if we want to become the extraordinary people of God, we need to be those who find and ask God to help us each moment, each step along the way, to look out for where we are being ordinary and acting in ways which are unhelpful, and to is to us. Sometimes we don't respond to what God gives to us because we haven't yet experienced it. Allow ourselves to know what grace is. Allow ourselves to know that actually I may be like that last worker hard at the last moment who doesn't deserve what I get. And therefore, I can't judge anyone else. Judgment is left to God, is what we are to be taught in the scripture. And we are to take that and live that. If we do, hopefully we can draw others into that. But if nothing else, we can help ourselves grow to be more like Christ, more extraordinary, loving and kind, more generous and caring. We pray that God may help us in that. Amen. So we kneel or sit for our prayers of intercession.
Please, I'd like you to respond when I say, at all times, with me, God be with them. Eternal and ever-loving, ever-present God, in the struggle and joys of the day, we pray. For those who are overburdened, weighed down, demoralized, fearful, or desperate because of what life has thrown at them, at all times, may God be with them. For those engulfed in pain and anguish, facing illness and death, at all times, may God be with them. For those troubled in mind and spirit, who find no peace or calm, at all times,
may God be with them.
For those alone and lonely, without friend or comfort, at all times, may God be with them. For those frightened and bewildered who see no direction or purpose in their lives, at all times,
may God be with them.
Eternal, ever-living God, bless them all in this and every hour and every step of life's journey. Amen.
Amen.
We stand, share Christ's peace together. We are the body of Christ in one spirit. We were all baptized. May we pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life. May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
It's of one another a wave of peace or something like that. So as I prepare the table, I'm going to put some music on, and you can use that for your own personal prayers or reflection. And then when the table is prepared, I'll stop the music and we'll continue with the communion. The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Why is it right to give thanks and praise? Listen, and we will hear. Lord of all life, you created the universe where all living things reflect your glory. You gave us this great and beautiful earth to discover and to cherish. You gave us your grace, undeserved goodness towards us, pouring out your own life for us that we might live. And you made us all each wonderfully different, to join with the angels and say your praise. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Father, because when we turned away, you did not reject us, but you sent Jesus your Son. He gave his life for us on the cross and showed us the way to live. Send your Holy Spirit, that these gifts of bread and wine may be for us Christ's body and his blood. For on the night before he died, when darkness had fallen, Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, broke it, and shared it with his disciples, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this to remember me." After they had eaten, he took the cup of wine. He gave thanks and shared it with his disciples, saying, "This is my blood, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins." So, Father, with this bread and this cup, we celebrate his love, his death, his risen life. As you feed us with these gifts, send your Holy Spirit and change us more and more to be like Jesus, our Saviour. Help us, Father, to love one another, as we look forward to that day when suffering is ended and all creation is gathered in your loving arms. And now, with all your saints, we give you glory, through Jesus Christ, in the strength of the Spirit, today and forever. Amen. And we pray together the Lord's Prayer using the words on the order of service. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Draw near with faith, eat and drink in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts, by faith, with thanksgiving. I will bring the communion to you, and again there will be some music as we have the communion, which you can use for your own reflection and prayers. Thank you. Keep, O Lord, your church with your perpetual mercy. And because without you our human frailty cannot but fall, keep us ever by your help from all things hurtful, and lead us to all things profitable to our salvation and the benefit of others. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
We join together in the final prayer from the order of service. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Go forth into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold on to that which is good. Return to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honour everyone. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. We go into the world to walk in God's light, to rejoice in God's love, and to reflect God's glory. Amen.
Amen.
In his name we go.